Were you ready for it this morning, people? That was the right to left wipe special effect.
The good old mug wipe. Hey, everybody. Hey, look, it's like we're like twinsies.
Good morning. Oh, yeah. Jeez, I didn't even realize that. Excellent.
It's the blue. The boys in blue.
Well, it's a good morning for blue, I think. It's a beautiful day here in Phoenix, Arizona.
Yeah. Rub it in.
Something like 33 degrees Celsius. Did I get that?
Oh, you're talking Celsius now.
Did I do my math right?
You probably did. I mean, that sounds like that's a pretty warm day, I would say. So.
Yeah. Well, we got some pretty warm days around here, so yeah. I'd say we're like 33, 35, something like that.
Uh-huh. Very cool. Jack was asking how I'm doing. Yeah, I seem to be well on the mend. Wisdom teeth have now left, so I'm a little less wise, I guess. Not that anyone would have thought I was wise to begin with, but things came together very well for me on that front. So,
or they came out okay.
Well, they left me. Well, I was out, so I don't know how well they came out.
I love that they actually put you out to get the teeth out. Now I wasn't wide awake, but they just gave me the happy gas.
Okay.
And they just went at it. Yeah.
Yeah, mine were fairly impacted, and the dentist said, yeah, you're not going to be awake for this.
You're not going to enjoy this one bit, Mr. Van Wingerden.
No, there was some discomfort involved, ultimately, so, yeah.
Yeah, hey, everybody, you know, we're missing our guest today. If anybody happens to know where she is, it would be super cool for her to be here, because we'd love to talk augmented reality design with her. She has a great new design model to share, and you know, we'll have her back. We're casual this way, you know. If she had something pop up and couldn't make it, that's okay, because we actually have a couple other things to talk about anyways. Also, one in particular, ATD and the fantastic inaugural first annual idiotic meetup.
Yeah, idiotic live and in person. It's going to be, you know, a mug fest. Hey, that's a good name for it. Let's call it mug fest.
Ooh, that's a good one. That's it. We just got a hashtag for our event is now mug fest. And you guys can get registered by just like right there. There's a button. If you click on that button, we would love to know how many of you are going to be checking it out and joining us. The better, the closer number we have to the amount of people that are going to be there, the easier it's going to be for us to get you guys some coffee. We'll also be able to decide how many mugs to bring, perhaps, maybe some giveaways. I know we've got an interesting giveaway going on right now.
Yep. Sierra has also put the link in the Eventbrite link into the chat. And Alice, can you just attend without going to ICE? I'm not sure that would be possible, because it is within the confines of the conference, but we can find out. I don't know.
I don't think they have like guards in front of the larger conference center. They may like say, hey, do you have a badge going into each one of the rooms? If you're not going to be at the conference, all we ask is that you just come up to us and just say hi.
Yeah. It's the Wednesday of ATD, which is the third day, and we're doing it bright and early, roughly 7:30 through till about 9:30, a bit of a hangout. And we plan to try to pull off something, you know, live for the actual idiotic session that day from the event as well. Just be kind of fun to have folks in the room with us. And if you can ping us on the Eventbrite, just let us know if you are fairly confident you're going to be able to join us that morning. There is not a keynote that morning, which is why we picked that morning. So we don't have to compete with Oprah or Seth, you know. Anyway,
as the case may be, yes.
I could see where you might prefer one of them over coffee with us, as crazy as it sounds.
I can't understand that, Chris, one bit. Jeez.
No kidding.
We have much more to talk about, I think.
Yeah. Well, yes, and we're probably equally well known.
Oh yes. Oh yes. The idiotic book is coming out soon, right?
Yeah, it's gonna be color by numbers.
Instructional design by numbers. Hey, you know, that could work.
Yeah, we could tie it into the, I don't know, some sort of color mood board or something. And
we're on a branding roll this morning.
There we go. Yeah, so if you're going to be able to join us, pop into there and to the Eventbrite and let us know.
Yeah.
Because it will help us determine where we need to put this, because we're trying to sort out, you know, a bit of space and how much space we need. How much coffee do we need to bring? Those kinds of things. So. Yep. The other thing Brent was alluding to, something that we're starting up as well is we're going to start, people seem to be fans of these little things, which we're getting a heck of a chuckle out of that. And it's a lot of fun. So we're going to give some away. And so next week, at the start of next week's session, we will do a draw from all the people who have attended in April and give some mugs away and send them all along. So,
They are a tad bit bigger than a normal mug. Yes, they are.
When I go to our coffee machine, which, and I pick the normal size coffee, it's about there. So there's lots of room. There's lots of room for lots of coffee for sure. A nice potter, a pot if you wanted to grow a cactus or other things on your window. And there's Joe. I love big mugs and I cannot lie. I'll drink to that.
I will drink to that. So I drank mine about halfway down and then I refilled it on the Keurig and I pressed the large button and it did not overflow on the second cup. So you can get like a good large and a half Keurig pour. So I don't know how many ounces
Donna,
that
it
is.
That's actually the shape of it, Donna, too. It almost, it's almost moving into bowl status for a nice latte. So
yeah, exactly. We can.
Sierra from our team is telling me that she can fit two coffees in that mug. She may have done that a couple of times here at the office. Yeah.
Yeah, somebody's got to do it.
Yep. Yeah. So there's a couple of things that we have going on, and I'll do another quick check and see if we've been able to get Debbie in with us yet or not. In the meantime, anybody got anything that's on their minds? We'd be happy to throw out some questions to the collective. Anybody trying anything really cool or new these days?
And don't think we can't talk about augmented reality still, folks. So we can definitely talk about some aspects of it. I know I've experienced it a little bit when it first came out. Haven't done any learning projects with it yet, I will say. But if you have, let us know. What can you tell Flo? Oh, Jeff, you're so nice.
You're so accommodating. Yeah.
Throw in.
Truthfully, we're always reluctant to talk product here because this isn't. We don't. We're not looking for a. We're not looking for a forum to talk. Product, but yeah, Jeff. The rollout of what we've got is called Domino One. Most recently, and it includes both our Flow and Claro authoring in the same place. So, yeah. Beyond that, Jeff, happy to catch up with you later and via email or what have you and answer the other questions that you've got there. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Jack said, I had an interesting chat with someone yesterday about how to bridge the topics of leadership, AI and data in analytics, but adding in, I don't know a lot about any of those things. Well, yeah, we're all kind of fumbling towards knowledge in terms of AI and analytics, both data analytics. Yeah. Any other, Jack, maybe a little bit more context. Was this someone who is starting to implement this or just an idle chit chat kind of a thing. How does that even come up, Jack? Someone who was just curious about the whole idea of it. Yeah.
Well, I mean, we could even brainstorm it a little bit. I mean, because that's, let's think about it, right? We all have watched or heard somebody talk about each of these categories. So if you're thinking about leadership, AI, and data analytics, I'll even just take us back a little bit to last Wednesday. I know you weren't here, Chris, but Shannon Tipton talked a little bit about soft skills stuff. And how we might do some AI perhaps around that, or I mean AR. She has she actually did some really cool stuff with chat bots, I think is the other one. But if we're talking about AI, I think personally, so I'll just give my quick opinion on this. I think with leadership and soft skills stuff, it's going to be a lot harder for us to do self-paced e-learning and whatnot. I happen to be a big fan of coaching and mentoring and actually really, pairing people up with other leaders and making sure that works, a real human aspect to it. I think some of the tactical things of leadership can be taught, right? Informational knowledge type stuff. But the type of things that leaders need, or people moving into leadership roles, the type of things that they need to be changing about themselves are things that take a long time and it takes practice, and it takes being held accountable to other people, and those people that are holding you accountable understanding how to hold a leader accountable without causing too much friction and those types of things. So it gets pretty tricky when you start to talk about leadership stuff, because I think it's very, very different than the typical training and L&D stuff that we do. And I only just recently started really heavily thinking about this a lot when I started, connecting more with my friends at PeopleFirm and listening to them. And they've given a couple sessions at events for me, and they talk a lot about they've connected with a lot of executive leaders, and they've learned a ton in how they do what they do. And so, and I've, of course, have had conversations with them over coffee, I might add, trying to figure out how do we automate some of that, right? And can we, and what type of tech can support that sort of leadership, mentorship, coaching type aspect? And I think AI can play a role in that, as can analytics, right? If you can track some of those interactions. But in general, it's going to be really interesting, I think, where our industry goes, where technology goes in general to support people as they move into leadership roles. It's a long-winded way of saying that.
Yeah, Jeff is adding in, yeah, you pair them with leaders that show desired behavior, values, and performance. Because certainly, a lot of leadership is, modeling is going to have to be quite a key thing. You can't make up, you can't arrive at, I don't think, generally speaking, new behaviors of your own very easily without seeing them illustrated, enacted, modeled for you by other people. Even reading a book on leadership, that's actually one of the things I've always wondered. You read a book on leadership and, how translatable is that without models? And I know you can use anecdotes and stories and those sorts of things. It's one of those things where, it's the separation between understanding something conceptually versus, applying it, more successfully in the real world.
Yeah, and I think it depends upon the personality too, right? I've read a lot of books about take any topic, getting organized, and I would say that I grab a little snippet or two from each one of the books that I read, but am I any more organized than I used to be? Maybe a little bit, but that's only by brute force and, being aware of it all the time. A lot of leaders really, or people that are in higher level roles within the hierarchy of an organization, they don't even really feel like they have a problem or that they need to learn anything. And so that's a whole nother issue. How do you train somebody to be a better leader, or, you know, if they don't even feel like they need to be doing it better than they are?
Mm-hmm. Oh, Molly threw in a note, facial recognition, which is something I saw probably the same info yesterday, that Apple is being sued for falsely recognizing someone for a crime that he didn't commit. And there's quite a lump sum involved in that potential lawsuit. It led to his, if I recall the info correctly, the facial recognition led to him being arrested by the police, but it wasn't him.
Hey, Debbie's here.
Oh, cool. Let me go back and to the list of folks. There's Debbie. We shall invite Debbie onto the screen. Hopefully she's ready to go.
Oh, I should have been more clear in my email.
Oh.
Here! Sorry.
Hi, good morning, Debbie.
Good morning.
Very cool. Good morning.
I apologize. I didn't notice the ET on the date.
Ah. Yeah, I kind of thought maybe time zones were involved, because that's, you know, that's such a human thing. But in general, you're doing okay this morning, Debbie?
I'm just fine. I have my tea, and I'm ready to go.
Very cool. Very cool. Very, very cool. Yeah, well, we went down a pathway of some, based on some questions in the chat this morning, a little bit about leadership and AI and some related kind of things. So we've been having a decent chat for a little bit here, but this is pretty awesome. I actually I've been looking forward to this conversation quite a bit, because AR and VR, although I've had, you know, small touches with them, just, you know, sort of experiencing the idea of what they're about, but haven't really started beyond just sort of saying, "Ooh, this could be cool if," but haven't myself started thinking very firmly about, hey, what are the good things to do? What are the ways to do this properly to fit into, you know, good training, good learning and development practices and those sorts of things. So I've been really looking forward to this time here this morning. Oh, did we lose Debbie again? Or
might just be refreshing.
Yeah.
Getting a new webcam up. Yeah, the design aspects of AR is going to be fun to talk about, because I had no idea that somebody had thought it through so deeply to come up with a new design model that would work more effectively with a new technology like AR. So that's the part I think is pretty cool.
There, she's back. Cool. So one of the things I thought maybe just start out kind of just quickly, Debbie, would be maybe helping us understand that, because there are those two terms, AR and VR, that we have. And maybe just a little clarity around maybe the difference between the two.
Sure. And I'm getting a little bit of feedback.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if anybody else is.
You might have two browsers open.
Okay, let me just double check.
Two tabs of Crowdcast. That happens sometimes.
I think that's what it was. That's better. I can hear everybody now. I was getting this weird, really strange echo, and I was trying to figure out what everybody was saying. So, I think there's a challenge in understanding the difference between the types of immersive technology, especially around VR and AR. And simply what I tell people is that when you are viewing something in AR, you're overlaying some sort of virtual experience on top of the real world. Usually you're using your smartphone to do that, to view the augmented reality experience. Whereas with virtual reality, it's an immersive experience. You've got a headset on that blocks out your view of the real world, and you're experiencing something in true virtual reality. a part of the confusion, I think, too, is in some cases with AR, you may use glasses like the Microsoft HoloLens glasses, but those glasses don't block out the entire world for you. You're still able to look and see and view objects in the real world. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's a good definition. The idea that, as you say, augmented reality adds something to, oh, gee, augments. That's the word, isn't it? the things that, you know, that you are able to see, whereas the, you know, virtual reality is, it replaces that, for sure. Yeah, I like that very much. So, so maybe a little bit about how you've ended up playing around in this space, exploring it, et cetera, and as maybe the next thing to talk about.
Certainly. So in my day job, I work as a consultant to enterprise organizations, and I'm always on the lookout for the next big thing, the things that they need to be thinking about down the road. So immersive technology is that next big thing. And so with a lot of my clients here in Houston, I work with clients in oil and gas, in technology, in the medical community. So these technologies are a natural fit. But I think the big challenge for these organizations, number one, is how do they figure out what they're going to use the technologies for, what's the best fit, how to plan for the technologies, both from a budget standpoint. Are they going to need extra manpower? Is it going to add to the expenses that they're going to have to incur? And then how do they get other departments involved? Many times, things that happen in the L&D world are caused by other departments. For example, one of my clients is a big manufacturing organization, and their safety manager went to a conference and saw a bunch of cool things and came back and said, I want to do this. And so the department had to kind of shuffle and say, okay, well, let's see what we need to do. But taking a step back and figuring out whether or not, number one, it's a right fit, and how does that fit into the big picture is always challenging. And that's where I come in. I help them with that.
That is always it's a blessing and a curse to have an executive leader say, I want to do that. Yeah, go. At the same time, they expect you to work miracles because they saw something really cool at a conference. But, you know, it's a better place to start than them saying, no, we don't want to do that.
This is true.
So then moving from just sort of the notion then of things that could be helpful or things that, you know, that we could take advantage of, to start thinking then more practically about how and how we do that. And for today's topic, we've got that ADDIE model in there, but, you know, with a bit of a modification. So maybe tell us a bit about that.
Sure. So I've been working on this project for, gosh, over a year now with Hugh Seaton. He's with Aquintis. And what we wanted to do was to come up with something that would help organizations who are beginning to participate in immersive technologies to come up with some of the things that they would need to go back to their organizations and truly understand how that infrastructure was going to be different. So we came up with the ADDED model. So that's ADDIE. And we just added a couple of iterations to the overall ADDIE model for folks to think about. And some of the things are the same things that we think about anytime we involve ourselves in any sort of new technology. So first, in the analysis stage, we think about, of course, what do learners need, what's missing from the current approach, and then whether or not using an immersive technology such as virtual reality or augmented reality helps solve that need. So, you know, that would be the same thing that we would do with anything. We do that with using mobile technology or anything else. So we really need to still do that analysis phase because we've got to make sure it's going to be the right fit. And then once we do that, the first D that comes in before design then is determine. And so in the determine stage, we look at what technologies do we need to achieve our goal. So making a decision, if we say we want to use some sort of immersive technology, is it a better fit for virtual reality or augmented reality? And what's going to be the trade-offs of using those things? And I really feel in this stage too, this is the first stage that we start to involve other departments. Just when, like, a few years ago when we started saying that we wanted to develop and deploy on mobile, we had to get our IT departments involved to make sure that we were able to use mobile devices. Anybody who went down the path without getting IT involved probably got a rude awakening a little bit later. So it's really important to get IT involved at this stage, particularly with augmented reality, because many augmented reality experiences happen through using some sort of smart device, whether it's a smartphone or a tablet, because it's a multi-tiered function. So you have the marker that you're going to use to kick off the augmented reality experience. And then you have to have an app or something that's going to recognize that marker. And then the augmented reality experience appears. So that means that you may have to either create an app or use an existing app, such as Zappar or something else, or an existing technology to have that experience. And so, first of all, you have to get, and like I said, I work with a lot of enterprise organizations, and I know that with IT, you have to get their permission, especially if the application is going to reside on a company-issued smart device, to put that app on the device. And then once you get that permission, then you need to test it to make sure, and you need to get it thoroughly vetted by the IT department. So that's one of the challenges that happens during that determined phase of the added model. And I'll stop just for a second in case you guys have some comments or you want to share some information.
And part of it, I think, IT, that's, I mean, we all kind of know that. We've all learned our lessons probably on that, but making sure that that's clearly part of the path and figuring that out before you decide to then invest in the app and time and effort in making something, obviously let's you clear those hurdles. I'm going to guess budget's part of that determination too. You know, how much do these various solutions cost, and then and maybe a comparison against, you know, the value of solving the problem.
Certainly. And there may be a large financial investment. For example, if you're going down the path of virtual reality, you're going to have to invest in additional equipment. For example, if you're going to have a virtual reality experience in a lab, or you're going to have it in a training room, you're going to need a pretty high power computer to drive that virtual reality experience, especially if it's an experience that is truly immersive. So looking at the type of headset, the other equipment that you need, you really need to take that into consideration as well. So there may be a capital investment for both the department where the training is going to reside, or if you're going to have that in your training room as well. So those are some of the other things that you need to look at. And those things may change over the course of the development. And that's something that we've really seen, is that it's a very much an iterative process. So there's a lot of prototyping that you do to make sure that you're using the right technology, and that you're also, whoops, sorry, that was my alarm to let me know that I needed to get ready for the session. So just making sure that you have tested it, and you don't get down too far down the path before you start developing and experiencing those things. And also, we really like to have something for everybody to test and to experience, because especially with immersive technology, if you don't experience it early on, the light bulb doesn't go off. So having something that you can experience, get the headsets on some folks, let them experience virtual reality, give them some augmented reality experiences. I do stuff as simple as in a meeting, I'll have Google Translate out and I'll have a document that's in a different language and I'll overlay that and show them how it displays and translates the language. You know, I'll have another example that will show a video or whatever I'm doing, just so they have a little bit of an experience of what that might be like. And so that they have a better understanding. It's crucial for you to do that for stakeholders, influencers, people who are involved with the project to understand what you're looking at and how involved it's going to be. And making the decisions about whether or not it's going to be a simple experience or a more complex experience. I really advise people when they're first starting off with immersive technologies to do the simple experience first, get some feedback from a pilot team before you go, you know, into that $200,000 dynamic virtual experience that's going to take a year to develop and a lot of manpower. You know, let's do something small and simple and just experiment and make sure that it fits the culture of the organization, that you get some folks really excited about it so they'll start talking about it and that it's the right fit. You don't want to just dive into the pool. Like Alan, I just want, looking at the comments, you want to dip your toe in the water first. So that's very, very important. So then we fall back into the ADDIE model and we walk into design. And in design, you're going to design your scenario and think about the narrative and then think about learning science and everything else about how you're going to design this experience. And again, you may have a simple paper prototype to explain how you're going to do that, something to share with everyone just so I have an understanding of what you're doing. And we get now into our first E, which is our experience, okay? And that is something that we've added. And here we think about our prototyping, and this step may be the iterative step where we're thinking about how we integrate this experience into a course. And that's one thing I'd really like to say is I don't consider an immersive environment a replacement for a training course. I feel like it's a part of a blended learning experience. It may be, you may start off with somebody taking an e-learning course that's give them a basic understanding, a baseline of what you're trying to do. And then you may have them have a virtual experience where they go in, for example, if they're trying to perform a task. So they do it in the virtual environment and there may be a mentor that helps guides them through that. In a virtual environment, you could have a monitor where somebody could see what you're seeing in that virtual space, or they could participate with you in that virtual space so they can guide you through that experience. One of the things that Hugh has shown is with a project where there are people who are stacking boxes and trying to get them in correct order inside of an airplane. So they can do that in virtual space rather than real space, other than trying to find an empty airplane in a bunch of boxes to load than there. So that's that muscle memory and testing and working with a mentor. And then you may take them out into the real world and they have that experience. And then finally, you may want to do an assessment and test their knowledge to make sure that they're doing everything right. So that immersive experience becomes a part of an overall blended learning strategy. So we do that and we need to see what is needed before and after that experience. And then also what analytics are we going to collect or are analytics needed? Do we need to include some sort of XAPI into that immersive experience and capture statistics and information about what's happening? So I'll stop and let you guys share anything if you'd like to as well.
Well, I like that the new use of the letters points out sort of the iterative aspect and separates the design and makes explicit, I think, is what I'm thinking. Basically, the proving of the design, the testing of the design, versus jumping straight into implementation, for instance, makes it much more explicit because it is such a, I mean, it's going to be a big budget crunch to have gone and done something, put it out there and go, turns out we were wrong and we spent all that money poorly in that model. So it's very cool that I think and very valuable to be able to separate those out and to say, you've got to move through this as a clear step. And then everybody's in the same headspace when they're part of the project.
Certainly. Then the next step in the added model, rather than the ADDIE model, is the development. And in the development stage, we look at what the early prototypes have told us, and then how does the existent of our, oh, it's ADDIE.
I know. I couldn't figure out how to get the two raised up, so it'd be like AD squared and ED squared.
maybe we need to hip it up, Alan. I'm going to tell Hugh that. again, the development stage is an iterative stage again, and there's all sorts of things that we can do when we develop, especially when we're prototyping, and we're doing that first project to get us through these stages a little quicker. I'm working with a group now, and we were talking about how we're going to develop a project. And I've been around in this business for a long time. One of my first companies I started was a multimedia company. And in the multimedia company, we did a lot of smoke and mirrors. So we created a lot of 3D animations that were basically boxes that were skin wrapped with images. And so when we're developing some of our VR experiences, I tell folks, you don't need to create a total VR environment. Windows don't have to open unless you have that as part of the task. You could just have a painted image or a background that doesn't do anything. You don't need to recreate the world unless you're really involved in the world. So as we're developing, we need to think about that. We need to think about what are some of the things that are key to what we're doing. If it's a piece of machinery where we've got to turn knobs and we've got to push levers and things, of course, those need to be precise. But if there's a table off in the distance with a light, and you're never going to turn the light on, it could just be a picture, you know. And that's going to cut down a lot of costs because people get so excited about recreating the virtual world, but it doesn't have to be totally virtual. And the same thing with the augmented experience. The augmented experience, you can have information that's text-based. You can have a video that you're playing, but again, you don't have to have a really high-end experience if you're just providing some basic information. You need to think about what you're doing and how that affects the learning experience and what is needed. So that kind of ties back, you know, going back and forth between some of those different stages. But just think about that when you're developing, especially the first project. We come away with a set of rules and a set of standards for things that we want to do. And if you pilot, you'll also come away with some things that you don't want to do, a really good checklist. And I'm going to do a real quick plug, if that's okay. I've written something for ATD. It's a TD at work that was done for the January, and it's about getting started with augmented reality. And in the back of this, I have a job aid, a couple of job aids that talk about questions that you need to do to get started, and then also a questionnaire about information. And if you would like, I'll I'll send a copy to Brent. And Brent, if you want to put it out there on the page or something, if people want to come back and get that, you're happy. I'm more than happy to do that, to just give you a good checklist of things to consider to get started. Cool. And then I'll also include the link on where to buy the article if you want to. And if you're going to ATD ICE, it'll be in the bookstore, so you can get it there as well.
Yeah, I was just going to say, if you've got some hard copies you want to bring to our idiotic meetup while we're at ATD, you can, we'll be happy to, like, you know, maybe do like a giveaway along with your pamphlet and a mug.
All well. Right. I will do that. I will do that. It's a 10, it'll cost you probably $10 to $20 in the bookstore, but I'm happy to give away some for free at our meetup as well. Nice. So I'm going to talk about the last step in the added model. I noticed Alan is doing a really good job of hipping it up there and Duncan put the link to the article out there in chat as well. Thank you, Duncan. So let's talk about the last D, which is deploy. And in deployment is thinking about what do we need to do to deliver the experience, and what do we have to include on the client side for seamless integration? So from the AR standpoint, making sure that you give explicit instructions on how people will have the experience is very important. So you need to give them the three basic steps, the information about loading the application, how do they scan, and then what happens after they scan the marker to see the experience. From a VR experience, you need to make sure that you have specific instructions. If it's going to be in a lab, then you need to have instructions on how to use that experience. If you're going to have a mentor, how the mentor is going to help the person with the VR headset, what to do if you have issues, how to get everything started, and then what are the things that you're capturing, and making sure that that you're doing something with that information. How are you going to report back and show your success with the technology? So, and all of those things are useful, because the next thing you're going to do is you're going to come back and you're going to say, okay, we did this pilot. We were successful. Here are the lessons we learned. Now we're ready to do our next project. Let's go back and find that project and make sure that we're meaningful again and mindful of what we're doing, and that we're making those right choices to do a project that's going to fit the needs of the organization and be a great immersive experience for the learner as well.
Have you or Hugh written up about it? Is there a link we can go to read up more or to find out a little bit more about the ADDIE process?
So Hugh's got some information out on his website. It's the Aquintis website. And I don't know, Duncan, if you're a fast Googler, if you can go out and find that and share that with everybody. I can also provide that afterwards. We've also written a couple of blog articles about it. And we were guests at the event in January with you, Brent, and we did a whole session. And there's a recording of us talking about immersive technology as well. So Duncan just put the link to the Aquintis website out there for you guys so you can see that. I've been talking about getting started with augmented reality for a long time, and I'm doing a number of sessions this year. I'll be speaking. I'll do a new session at ATDI this year, and then I'll be speaking at Realities 360 this summer, and also at Learning Dev Camp. I'll give a plug out to Jason. Jason Pickle's conference is going to be happening in June. If any of you guys really want to go and spend a week in Salt Lake City at the University of Utah, it is a great experience. It's kind of a developers conference, and we get down and dirty. Yeah. And then also at Reality 360 in San Jose for the eLearning Guild, we'll be doing a lot of really cool stuff there as well. You'll be there, I'll be there. We'll be talking about immersive technologies.
Very cool. Yeah, so lots of resources, and we're going to get some follow-up things that we'll add to the conversation as well. I have a hunch that lots of folks are already hitting the link for the TD article already, and have that. that's what happens here. People start reading already. The enthusiasm spills over. So Molly's got a neat point. If you're doing VR, hygiene, cleanliness with the headsets, if they're constantly being used within that learning environment, you know, the first time. We have a VR set here, and we had a company event internally experiencing some of the initial sort of even just the default games and stuff that come with it. And that was my reaction. I put it on and went, oh, someone else has been wearing this. That was my first reaction to VR was, ooh, it's kind of gross.
Yeah. Hygiene is very important. I always keep those wipies around. I tend to not share my headsets. I actually bought a bunch of headsets to give away to people so I wouldn't have to share my headsets with them. And I think that's really important. But, you know, if you are thinking about sharing and showing some of these technologies, especially virtual reality, and you want to have some experiences with a group of your enthusiasts or stakeholders, you can buy cardboard Google glasses from Amazon for about $5. I bought a number of them and imprinted them with my company logo, and I bought a large quantity, but they ended up costing me about $3 or $4. So it's a cool way. It also gives them a chance to share with other people. So that's the secret sauce, is you're giving something that they can go back then and say, oh, look, this is a cool technology that we're looking at implementing. And that's so much more powerful if you give them those goggles, or you give them access to an AR site that they can use, then that is more valuable. I give a little card that has a little application that I built in Zappar. I have them download the Zappar app and then show them how that works and say, okay, now you can go back to your department and you can share this and show it as well. So that's really, really important. Get the word out, get people excited, get them thinking about what they can do, and then use the tools that you have as good instructional designers to help them create a great learning experience.
Very cool. With the new things, we it's sometimes easy to make a buzz, but it's also really important to have people understand not just that you're going to use it, you know, as a window dressing, but under, you know, that light bulb moment, as has been referred to earlier, of people kind of going, oh, I get it now, totally, as opposed to the abstract of, yeah, no, it sounds like it could be good, you know, moving them forward in that step. So that they can all catch up with the executive who was at the conference, who saw the really cool thing and came back and said, we should all be doing this. Mm-hmm. Very cool.
Exactly.
Excellent. This has been a heck of a cool thing to talk about today here, Debbie. Thanks so much for joining us. Lots of neat stuff that we've been able to share in the ADDED model. Some really neat things. And I think, you know what? I don't think this is reserved necessarily for augmented and VR. I'm hearing lots of things that actually make so many clear points, I think, about, you know, a good development process, period. So I think it's got lots of utilitarian value, even outside of the wow factor and the cool factor of what we're talking about here today. So very cool. Well, thank you so much for joining us. I'm hearing the music there, Brent. Shall we dance out?
Yeah, we shall. Thank you so much, Debbie, for hanging out
thank
with us.
Thank you.
Sorry about the mix-up there in the times.
I apologize.
Yeah, don't worry about it. I'm looking forward to seeing you at ATD and joining us at our meetup. That's going to be tons of fun. So all of you in the chat, if you're going to be there, hang out with us. We would love to have you.
Next week, we have Lisa Goldstein joining us, and I think I've got the Crowdcast link here if folks want it. Next week's session, check it out. Sign up soon, and we'll catch up with everybody again next week.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.